When you're around someone who's as sick as Mike, you have a couple of urges. One is to be really healthy. I mean, you want to get up and take your vitamins and eat your green leafy vegetables and exercise and meditate. But on the other hand, you have this equal urge to be really unhealthy. I mean, you want to eat fried foods and drive in fast cars and take up dangerous sports. And this one day, I was feeling really stressed out and really down, and I just needed a release of some kind. And I decided to do something a little unhealthy and dangerous. And for me, that meant I was going to smoke myself a cigarette and buy the new book by the Pope. Now, okay, as for the Pope, I'm not really a big fan of this Pope, as you can imagine, but I kind of enjoy disagreeing with him on so many topics. But it means that I have to really keep up with what he's saying and writing all the time, and this was the day that the Pope's new book had come out. Now, as for the cigarette, I really don't smoke, only very, very occasionally when I'm really under pressure. And my parents are militant non-smokers. My father smoked 2.5 packs of unfiltered Chesterfields a day until 3 years ago. And like most former smokers, he absolutely hates smoking, and he's always going on about the evils of smoking, and I always join in his tirades and agree wholeheartedly. But it means that if I am going to have a cigarette, I really have to hide it. Well, as I said, this one day, I was feeling really down. I just looked awful. My hair was just a disaster, and I didn't have any makeup on, maybe just a little lipstick. And I was wearing these overalls, which is a really bad fashion choice for me. And I thought, I can't stand it here anymore. I'm going to get out of here, and I'm going to smoke myself a cigarette and get the Pope's book. And I got into the car, and I went to West Hollywood to book Sue. And I walked in, and I thought, I'll get the book first. And I couldn't find the Pope's book anywhere, and I suddenly felt awkward asking for it. And I guess I was just hoping that there would be a big 10-foot cardboard cutout of the Pope, you know. And then I did find it, and like somebody buying pornography, I suddenly felt that I should get something for on top of it and underneath it. So, you know, that it would say to the clerk, you know, I'm interested in what the Pope has to say, among other things. So, I started wandering around Book Soup looking for something else to get, and I was really spiraling downwards, and I found myself in the self-help section. And I was looking up at the books, and there was one book entitled The Atheist's Guide to Getting Through the Day, There Is the Tomorrow. And I thought, huh, that's interesting that someone would take the time to write that book. And I thought, I guess I'm just looking for the book, What Happens When Your Brother Gets Cancer and Your Entire Family Moves In With You. Where is that book? And I was feeling worse and worse. And at just this moment, and I hesitate to report this to you because, well, because it's embarrassing, and also because I'm not into scatological humor in any way, but at just this moment, I suddenly let out the loudest fart. And it was like a foghorn had gone off at Book Soup. And everyone's heads whipped up. And I didn't know what I should do. I didn't know if I should, you know, flee the scene or if I should look around like it wasn't me. But of course, I just ended up standing there like a deer caught frozen in the headlights, you know, with the Pope's book. Humiliated, and at just this moment a head came from around the bookcase and this guy said, Julia? Julia Sweeney? And I said, yes. I wanted to say, you recognize my call? And I said, yes. And he said, remember me? It's Marshall from the Growling Theater. Well, of course I didn't remember Marshall, but I did what I always do in that situation, which is to overcompensate. And so I said, oh, Marshall, Marshall, Marshall. Oh, gosh, it's just so great to see you, Marshall. And he said, hey, how you doing? How you doing? So, are you still on Saturday Night Live? And I said, oh, you know, I'm just really not on that show anymore. And he said, so what are you working on now? And I said, oh, you know, just Nothing. And he said, oh, and he said, hey, how's that Steve? You know, you two are the cutest couple. And I said, oh, Steve's doing really well, but, you know, we got divorced. And he said, oh, and then I tried to make my escape, and he came up behind me and he said, hey, how's Mike? Still running the box office at the Groundling Theater? That Mike Sweeney is so funny. And I said, oh, actually, Mike's taking a little time off from work right now because he has cancer. Well, nice seeing you, Marshall. And I took my book up and I paid for it. And you can imagine at this point how much I really, really wanted a cigarette. So I got out of book soup and I went up to this corner market and I got my pack of cigarettes and I got back in the car and I thought, okay, there can be no smell of smoke in this car because I know the next morning we're all going to be loading into it to take Mike to chemo. So I rolled down all the windows and I started heading east on Sunset and I lit up my cigarette and I was kind of holding it outside the driver's window and I was smoking it and I was enjoying this cigarette like nobody has ever enjoyed a cigarette. And I had tears running down my cheeks, but I was just weirdly happy at the same time, and I felt so exhilarated to just be smoking and driving and to have gotten away from Marshall. And I got closer to my home, and I tossed the cigarette out of the car, and I turned onto my block, and I suddenly smelled something burning. And then I realized that my car was filling up with smoke. And I pulled into the driveway and I turned around and I realized that my cigarette must have flown out the driver's window and then back in the back passenger window and landed on my back seat and like ignited it and there was this little fire going there. So I jump out of the car and I open the back door and I get the fire out and the cigarette out of the car. And I go in the front door and my mother says, thank God you're back, I need your car keys, I have to go to the store. And I said, Oh, the most terrible thing just happened. And she said, what? And I said, well, I was just driving down Sunset Boulevard, and right next to me was this man, this old man in a pickup, and he was smoking. And my mother said, oh, smoking. Her reaction was so big, like that just might be my whole story. He was smoking. And he tossed his filthy cigarette out of his pickup and somehow it landed in my back seat and it burned this big hole there, which I'm sure you'll see. And my mother said, oh my God, that's the most horrible story I've ever heard. Bob, come out here and hear this horrible story. And so my dad came out and I told him the story and my dad said, now where was this guy? And I said, he was right over here. He was right over here on this side and my back passenger window happened to see the height of the hump. The next day, we all were, in fact, loading into the car to take Mike to chemo. And as we were, my father looked down to the grass and he kneeled down and he stood up and he said, hey, look, it's a cigarette. And I said, that's it. That's the cigarette the horrible old man was smoking. And my dad said, wow, because this cigarette has lipstick on it. And I said, oh, well, Sunset Boulevard.